Folks, if you remember, if you'll take the information that she gave you tonight and add it to any of your process building D&D portfolio information we've had from last month, we're kind of building that binder, that packet of information, so the bills won't be pushed. If by chance, maybe you can't find last month, or you might have misplaced it, I happen to know two young ladies that can help you track that down and get it all situated. It'll also be bound together in packets on the website, so you can find it there as well. All right, everybody doing well? We good? Okay, we're going to move now to a presentation from Jared Burns on the from Ohio Valley Archaeology, is that correct?
Yeah.
We're going to go over some of the archaeological surveys and do that on site.
Don't you have an acronym?
OVAI.
There we go.
How's that working?
Perfect. Good deal. Welcome, sir.
Howdy, everybody. Most of you don't know who I am. As he mentioned, I'm Jared Burks, and the other guy with me here is Albert Pecora. He's going to stand up and talk right after I go. I'm going to handle the prehistoric part, and he's going to talk about the historic cultural resources. We're both from Ohio. Our office is in Columbus, and we both got our PhDs at Ohio State University. Go Buckeyes. Thank God that season's over, right? we've been working on Ohio prehistory and history topics for some time now. I think we started graduate school in 94, so we've been around for a little bit. And my specialty is in the study of Native American earthworks and mounds. I spent some time up in Chillicothe at the National Park there, the World Culture National Historical Park. So we've got some exposure to some of these topics. And we were brought in originally by RSI, in particular, to take a look at the mounds and earthworks in the Ports area. So I will talk about that. As you may know, two reports have been finished recently on this topic. And I'll just give you a really quick rundown of what the findings are. Obviously, the reports are a lot more detailed than I can present in my little snippet of time here. The Scioto Valley is a pretty interesting area, and there are lots and lots of cultural resources here. And there are plenty right around here at Port. So I think for the next slide. So one of the reasons I guess that we were brought in was to sort of fill in the gaps and present the facts of what is known about cultural resources in this area. So my project was to kind of distill all this information from published accounts, so things that have already been written by folks over the last 180 years or 190 years or so, and then to try to track down archival sources that aren't published. Maybe they're available at the Ohio Historical Society or even farther out than that. And what I found in this distillation work is that my earthworks number there is around should be 3. There are 3 earthwork complexes in the area of Port. So an earthwork is an embankment of earth. Often they have ditches associated with them. Most are built for about 2,000 years ago. And these are the famous sites that the Hopewell culture built. The reason why that national park is up there at Chillicothe. So the 3 of them are Steele Township works here, and these numbers are state-based numbers that the state uses to keep track of these sites. So the great big enclosure there right off the southwest corner of Ports is kind of a famous one. First appeared in a big book on earthwork sites in 1848, so it's been known for quite some time. Second one is this little guy here. You can't even see it on this map. It's pretty small, but it's just out the west entrance there, right in the clover leaf area. It's really flat there today, so you can't see it when you drive by. But the ground there is still more or less intact, so there could be remains of that below ground. There was a mound there, too. And then the third one is way up by Mount Cemetery there. It's well away from the main Ports facility, but some of the Ports ancillary things like water lines run by there. So we wanted to make sure we could figure out where that one was, too. Next slide.
Jared, you want to?
Yeah, could you show me the third one?
Flip back.
Cemetery. Sorry.
Mount Cemetery.
Up
toward Pike. Yeah. That's the southern end of that earthwork site. It's a very large earthwork complex, and actually it's the one I'm going to talk about next. The report has detailed stuff on all of these sites, but I just, as an example, I wanted to talk about the Graded Way earthwork complex. This one is one that's been mentioned in like every prehistory book on Ohio for the last 200 years. And it used to be really easy to see, and Squire and Davis, these guys that had mapped the earthworks of Ohio. We're pretty enamored with it and talked about it a lot in their book in 1848. But right about the time when Ports began construction, this place totally disappeared from the landscape. So since the 1940s, this, except for the couple of mounds that are still really visible down here in Mound Cemetery, this place has been lost. The neat thing about the Graded Way site is that it's sort of its namesake are these parallel walls of earth that were about as tall, almost as tall as the ceiling here back in the day. As of 1946, which is the age of this slide, or this photo taken by ODOT way back when, we can see the remains of that right here very clearly is the western embankment of the Graded Way. At that time, it was, I think, 6 or 7 feet tall. And 600 or 700 feet long, so pretty long this. The other side, by 1946, had been destroyed by gravel miners. Just about 8 years later, the rest of that was destroyed when Route 23 was expanded. Now, where it used to be is underneath the BP station, with the Taco Bell there, and it heads south. So the next time you pump up, get gas there.
It's a new cultural resource.
Yeah, think about this earthwork that we have. I think BP is about right there. We were able to show definitively where that is, which is good to know. Next slide. There's a close-up of that.
The round thing is what again?
Round thing? This? Yeah, that post-dates our earthwork a wee bit. Next slide. So there shows it on a modern, more modern aerial photograph. So we've got mounds that are intact down here in Mount Cemetery. A few stragglers out here, and then the road and the railroad have taken out all this stuff in here, more earthworks, and this stuff's also all gone. So really just the bare bones of this thing is left.
No problem.
Next slide, please.
Is that their word, admit to the BP station now? There's a large mound-like hill behind that now. Is that a part of it?
No. That large mound-like hill is a natural feature. It's actually on the maps from the 1840s. Now they show that it's a old terrace. It runs all the way. This is it right here. This is that terrace goes all the way up here. It's kind of a high spot. It's above the floodplain, and the road cuts across it and down through it. So that's all natural ground.
Their ground.
That's the ground there.
Yes.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's the his house overlooks the bottoms.
Yeah.
That's the ground. So historically called the ground farm.
Yeah. And in fact, the guys in the 1840s they show a pond or something right in here that's now got some houses on it. So you know somebody that lives there and they have a crack in their foundation next door. They got a little bit of a landfill underneath their house.
It's a wetland.
Yeah, once was. The other thing I did, which was a little bit harder, was to try to track down all of the mounds that are in this area. So mounds are, big heaps of earth. A lot of them have burials in them or below them. They mostly date to about 500 BC up to about 600 AD. That's when most mounds were built in Ohio. And Ohio is known to have had something like 10,000 or so burial mounds here. And the Ohio Historical Society has on record only 2,000 mounds. So there are lots that are missing that have been destroyed over the years. New ones are found all the time, new old ones. So my goal was to try to track down the ones that have been mentioned in the literature. And these would be the big ones that are or were out there in the landscape in the Ports area. And there are something like a dozen or so that have been reported over the years here. Some of them are associated with the big earthwork complex down here. Others were just out here on the floodplain. One of the challenges was that the records at the Ohio Historic Preservation Office aren't necessarily correct. One of the mounds was plotted up here in this area, and when you read what was reported in the 1890s on this place, it actually was out here on the floodplain. So we were able to clear that up, and now it's gone. There's a big gravel pit there now, so the remains of that mound have been destroyed. That one had been excavated. A lot of them actually have been excavated, mostly in the 1890s by a guy named Gerard Fock. And he did that excavation work for the federal government, in fact, for the Bureau of Ethnology. A lot of the information that was learned in that came out in this really thick volume on mounds in eastern U.S.
Is there a question about, you said some of the mounds have been excavated.
Yeah.
Are you familiar with the terms of smoke hole?
Smoke hole. In what context?
Well, that signaling.
It's like when you're in college, yeah.
No. Well, what I'm getting at is on top of where you mentioned where there was a place where it was wrong, but on top of that hill, at Pike Hill, it looks like a mound has got it, but it's hollow, it's carved out. I've had people say it was, some people tell me that it could have been a sewer. There's another place not far from there, a mile, a huge one. It looked like a mound, but again, it looked like it had been possibly excavated. So
there's not a mound, there's a hole there. Is that what you're saying?
It was a mound, but they hollowed it out, but the mound is still there.
Oh, okay. Well, we find those a lot, even in known mounds, and that's usually where somebody has looted the mound. They've dug into it. And they've dug a big pit in the middle to try to get down to the burials and all the stuff that's usually with burials.
But you mentioned that there's still a mound up in that spot? Up on that terrace?
I'm not sure if there is or not. There's not one recorded there. The topographic data we have from there, which I'll show you in a sec, the kind of topographic data we have, doesn't show a bump up there.
I'm talking about two.
Yeah.
One on top of Pike Hill.
And
that's north. That's small. On 23 of that.
It's north of here.
Yeah, except just
way up
north side of Pike Hill.
There are a lot more mounds out there in the landscape. We've just focused on mounds kind of right around the forest.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The other is large.
Yeah.
That's the one I thought about. Both of them are hollowed out.
Yeah, they've probably been excavated. Let's see. Next slide. One of the things that is difficult to figure out with some of these excavations since they took place in the 1800s is where did all the artifacts end up? And one of the fun results of this documentation project was I was able to locate where all the artifacts are, which museum they're in. They're not in Ohio anymore. They've gone elsewhere. So a number of them ended up in the Smithsonian, and some of them are in the Penn Museum in Philadelphia. Next slide. And I was able to get the catalog records that show when these things first entered into these museums. So this one says Barnes Mound near Wakefield, Pike County, Ohio. That one's Larger Van Meter Mound near Piketon. The Larger Van Meter Mound is the one that was sort of lost. We discovered where it was out on the floodplain to the west of Portsmouth. One of the reasons why it's been hard to track this stuff down is the guy who excavated it, Gerard Faub, he was working for this rich fellow from Philadelphia, sort of. I think he bankrolled the project, the Philadelphia guy. And as a consequence, Falk just gave him all the artifacts. And this guy was affiliated with the Academy of Natural Sciences of Philadelphia. So he just donated all Ohio's artifacts to the Academy there. And then in the 1930s, the Academy decided they didn't want any artifacts anymore. They got rid of them. And some of them went to the Smithsonian, and some went to the Penn Museum. But the catalog records didn't go to the Smithsonian and the Penn Museum. So the Smithsonian knows they have artifacts from Pike County, but they really don't know where in Pike County. But they do have the original catalog records, the numbers over here, from Philadelphia. So they could know where they came from if they tried. They just don't, because they have 10 bajillion artifacts there. They can spend eons.
I thought that was worth 13.
13 bajillion? Could be, yeah.
Are any of the artifacts other than Native American artifacts? Are any other things that you're bringing to our attention or this family?
Albertville, yeah. I'm covering the Native American site.
Mm-hmm.
And this is just the previously documented Native American site. Okay, next slide. So this is the kind of stuff that's in the Smithsonian. One of the mounds, the Larger Van Meter Mound, which was out to the west of Ports, had a whole lot of burned fabric in it. So they saved some fragments of that. Other mounds had copper bracelets and stuff, which are pretty common to a culture called the Adena culture, and they're responsible for building a lot of Ohio's very large conical mounds. Then there are odds and ends, too. So So that's where we're at with the mounds and earthworks. The documented mounds and earthworks that we know about in this area all occurred outside the port boundary, mostly out on the floodplains to the west. And that's really common in the Scioto Valley. Most of these large earthworks and large mounds are in the floodplains in the Scioto Valley. Sometimes you'll get mounds in on the hills and stuff surrounding them. In fact, Falk dug one, which would be to the southwest of Piketon. There's a great big hill on the west side of the Scioto. There maybe there's a name for it, I don't know, the hill. But there were mounds up there that were excavated too. So any more questions about documented mounds and earthworks?
You gave a period of time there, was it about 600 BC?
Most of the mounds and earthworks in Ohio were built between about 500 BC and about 500 or 600 AD.
And that's the Edina?
The Edina and the Hopewell.
And the Hopewell, okay.
Right. Yes. So all of those mounds near ports are the result of Edina and Hopewell. Next slide.
What was your comment about on plan site? You said it wasn't an area of...
So there are no known mounds that have been excavated or documented at any time in the past within the boundary ports.
What studies have been done to determine that, or just based on...
Just based on everything that's been published so far, which brings me to what you're asking, is I wondered maybe some had been missed on ports. So the only way to know that is to go out on ports and walk down the whole site. Well, as you guys know, that's a big place. There's a whole lot of nasty, undergrowth out there. It's quite hard to walk down ports. So we did the next best thing, and we did it virtually. The facility has been flown with some technology called LIDAR, which is basically just laser range finding. And in this case, it's flown in a plane. Next slide. So you fly a plane over that has a global positioning system in it. It shoots these laser beams down at the ground. They bounce back. And the plane receives the signal and figures out how long it took for that laser beam to go down and back. And in that way, it can create a three-dimensional map of the landscape. And the useful thing is, anything below the plane will cause a reflection. Buildings, people, birds, trees. We use software to filter out all that stuff so that we can just look at what's at ground level. Next slide.
That's a tree there.
So this is what we get back, kind of the raw data, a point cloud of data, so we can see the trees and the houses and such. Next. Then we filter that to produce maps like this. So here's Serpent Mound, located, 15, 20 miles to the west of Ports. Obviously, if you've been there, you know that this place is covered in trees. And there are a few buildings out there, but we've got this nice bare earth landscape we can look at. And if you've been out there and you stood sort of here where the tail is, you know that embankment is only like this tall, if that. And yet we can see it really quite clearly on this map. Next. Here's an example of one that's just upstream from here at the southern end of Ross County. And another thing you can do with this LIDAR stuff is you can vertically exaggerate it to make really, really low things bigger. And so this kind of looks like the Grand Canyon, but it's Ross County. Here's an earthwork there. It's about the size of this room, and it looks really tall, and it's not quite that tall. This is a case where this has never been plowed before, so it's pretty much intact. It's probably 2,000 years old. Here's another mound. I'm not sure that one's even recorded. Here's where somebody's house is or was. So one of the challenges with the LIDAR is, sure, we can see mounds and earthworks, but there are a lot of things in the last 200 years that have made bumps on the landscape that are unrelated to mounds and earthworks. So we have to filter those out if we're looking for new mounds. Next. There's a close-up view of that one. Next. So at ports, what I did was I carved ports up into, I think, 27 little 1 kilometer square blocks, and I put them on the computer and exaggerated them and put a light source sort of low on the horizon to cast shadows. And then I rotated those three-dimensional surfaces around and looked for bumps. Next slide. Here's a close-up of that area there. And
it's a landing ring.
You can see in here that there are lots of little bumps, some with interesting shapes, some that are really, really subtle. So I tried to get even really subtle stuff down to 10 inches tall. And I came up with 28 things, 28 topographic features that I couldn't immediately explain away as a landfill or something like that. I also looked at, obviously there's a big area of ports. Now, these latter day are reflected, I think, in 2000, in the last 10 years or so. I can't remember the exact date. I think it's 2005 or so.
Were they collected for this purpose?
No. They were, I'm not sure why they were collected. I assume to do things at ports, planning and stuff like that. But they're handy for this purpose because we can see through all the vegetation pretty nicely. I also looked at some older maps that predate ports from 1950s because there's a big area, obviously, inside the perimeter of roads that was pretty well flattened right in the early 1950s. So we don't have nice LiDAR data there to look for mounds. And in those early topographic maps from 1953, there were a few bumps in there too. Question? Question?
Yeah. What were you seeing there that you found, like, what, the middle one, for example, what size is this, that bump?
It's about this tall, 5 or 6 feet. And, you know, it's definitely smaller than the inside of this area here. It looks just like a mound on that. So what I had to do was go out to every spot and look at these and figure out what they are. And that one looks like a dump truck backed up and dumped the dirt and then left.
It's a mound.
It's a mound, but it's not a Native American mound. It's a more recent mound.
It's a Pike County.
It's right or wrong, right along Claude River. Next slide. So there's the 28 that I looked at. They're kind of spread all over ports. That one you were just asking about is number 16 right there. And believe it or not, I mean, since my research is mounds and earthworks, I was really gung-ho. I really wanted to find an undocumented mound, because that's kind of cool. And unfortunately, what resulted was that every single one of these, the ones that I could visit, the red ones there, and this blue one here, number 6, they're all some sort of recent thing. Number 7 was a really nice looking one on the LiDAR data. It was, I don't know, 10 or 12 feet tall and about the size of these tables here in the middle. But when I got there, it's right along the perimeter fence. The top of it's really flat. And there's a little berm about this tall that's following along the perimeter fence. It looks like a bulldozer went through there and just flattened out and kind of made a road, you know, along the perimeter fence. And that berm goes underneath the mound. That's not a good sign if you want your mound to be ancient, because that perimeter fence hasn't been there very long. So there's stuff like that I was looking for. Another one was this guy here, I think number 26. That was sort of in an interesting area of ports that I thought maybe hadn't been impacted very much. It looked very mound-like. Even in the field, it looked just like a mound. There's an enormous tree on it, too, that looked like it had some age, maybe it dated to before ports. And then when I got back to the office, I looked at a 1966 era photograph, and this whole area here is covered in buildings. This was a barracks area, and that thing is inside the barracks area. And looks like it was related to the construction work as well.
When so, did you do this study? What's the date of this?
Well, I did this summer, in like the worst times, like June. I had about every tick of course crawling on me at one point or another. It was a challenge to find these things because it was so overgrown, but I generated coordinates from the LiDAR data of where they were supposed to be, and I had a GPS, and I just had it sort of take me out to it, and once I arrived, usually it was easy to see. In some cases, they were so low, like some of these up in here, they were kind of hard to find. One of them there, I think number 18, that was pretty interesting. It was only like this tall, so it'd be one of the smallest ones that I had chosen, and when I got to the spot, it was actually a farmstead that we had excavated. Like earlier that year, it was the chimney fall from a building, so a historic property, and it kind of looked like a mound.
So the three that you didn't inspect, were you not able to find them, or?
The three that I didn't inspect, well, I couldn't go in here, and here.
I see.
And they actually have buildings and such on those spots now, so. If there were mounds there, there's no way for us to be able to know that now. Those were things that I saw on the 1953 topographic maps, and that's all the information.
So what was your conclusion?
Well, based on
mounds this, aren't us.
Based on the historic records and this LiDAR look, there are no obvious, you know, as in large mounds on ports.
It's more like an almond joy than the mound wall.
Is that not?
We're like an almond joy in the mountain there.
What is the 19, for those buildings right on top of those three mounds, three, four, and five? Did those, from the older photographs, they look like they could be mounds?
Well, so those were based on the contour maps that were made in 1953 of topography. And those were guys out there on the landscape with, I assume, stadia rods and kind of transit collecting data. So they, like, the data here, there was a data point taken, I think, every foot to make this map. And back in 1953, they didn't collect as much data. So I think they were just out there mapping things they could see. I don't have an example of it on here, but there's one in the report that shows what these topographic maps are. And they mapped every tree on Ports in 1953, and then they figured out a species. They mapped all the buildings, all the roads. And so they were pretty attuned to everything that was out there. There are old cattle ponds and stuff that they mapped, which you can actually see in the contours. So I think they would have gotten any good-sized mounds. I'm not sure they would have gotten small mounds.
So three, four, and five weren't on that?
They were, the reason I picked those out is that they were, there's a small rise there about the size that one would expect for a mound. So this is just a contour map, you know, topography. So they're just lines that these guys drew on the map. And they just say there's a bump there.
It
could just be the top of the, could just be the top of the hill.
Yeah, but you said they were fairly detailed in everything they did.
Yeah, yeah.
So, I mean, how do you dismiss all of this? This is pretty rough, too, even with all the, you know, even those current. I mean, you can't tell what you've done here, what was under there, because...
Under here?
Well, all that, that
where?
Whole...
Out here?
The whole thing, in the whole land inside River Road has been...
Oh, yeah. We have no idea what was in there.
I can tell you
actually that there were no large mounds inside Perimeter Road because they would have been documented in the 1800s. Every mound out here in the floodplain, documented. So, and in fact, it dug them.
What if it was inverted upside down and you didn't see it?
So I can't tell you 100% that there were no mounds in here, big mounds, but I'm pretty sure there weren't because they would have been talked about in the 1800s.
Go backwards.
Like all the other mounds. As far as small mounds go, now mounds can be a foot tall to 40 feet tall.
Yeah.
So the small ones, which may have been missed in the 1800s, and may have been missed in the topographic survey, we don't know about those. You're right. Any other questions?
Yeah, I think
the line variation of size is what you pointed
out. In mounds, sure.
Yeah. Well, what was the purpose? The purpose of the mound range from what? I mean, was it not just for burial of people, or why?
Well, in the earlier time period, the Adena, just about all of those mounds cover a large crypt that was dug into the ground, so usually rectangular hole, lined with logs, and layered in with bark, and people were buried in those. Then the mound was built on top of them, and as more people were added to the mound, it got bigger and bigger and bigger. So Adena mounds are like vertical cemeteries. Whereas Hopewell mounds, the Hopewell sites are like the big earthworks. Those mounds usually cover a spot where there used to be a building. And that building served as a mortuary center. People would bring the dead in there. They might be cremated. And some of them were buried, piles of cremated remains perhaps left on the floor or buried in small pits under the floor. Then those buildings were taken down and the mound was heaped up on top of it. So a lot of cases, Hopewell mounds aren't burial mounds. They cover a spot where there was something related, usually to mortuary activity. Yeah. So they often involve burial, one way or another.
Great.
Jerry?
Yeah.
Just there was a comment on when you talked to the consulting parties about some firms down by the river.
Oh yeah, the dikes.
Some of these people may be familiar with those down there, so that might be interesting. I'm just giving you your take on that.
Berms down by the river. Well, there are an awful lot of linear embankments out here on the floodplains, and most of them were built for flood control over the last 120 or 30 years. We attempted to, just as an exercise, I suppose, figure out when exactly those were built, and we looked at the earliest maps we have of that area that would have information about those are from about 1915 or so, and they're already on there. So we know that they were built at that time or before. And as far as we can tell, what was it, Albert, maybe in the 1890s?
A lot of them were built in response to the, I think there was a flood in 1889 and the flood in 1913. And people just at that, around that time, were in response to those floods, started building those levees for flood control. And they were privately constructed. Back then, we didn't have the nanny state to build things for us, but it had been an amazing undertaking for private people to construct them. But they are, I mean, relatively recent. We were pretty confident that they would not and are not things that Native Americans would have built.
Okay, so Albert now is going to talk about some of the activities at historic era archaeological sites within Ports.
And many of you guys know about a survey that was done in 1996. And we're kind of showing that on this slide here. And that survey was pretty much designed to be sort of a pilot study or a sample survey of Ports back at that time. And the gray polygons that we have marked here show the areas that were actually surveyed during that 96 survey. They also went around and looked for some of the farmsteads that were on Ports and recorded those. And I think at that time, I know they recorded 36 archaeological sites. Most of them, those are farmsteads. There's two prehistoric lithic scatter sites. One of them down here is 33 PK210. And that was the last of the archaeological work up until pretty recently. And then they decided to do some phase two work, which is a little bit more extensive investigation of the farmsteads. And again, those are all the sites located here. And I think there's 13 of them that were selected for the phase two study. And we had a good fortune to investigate some of those. And during the course of our research, we realized that there are many other historic farmsteads located on Ports that were unaccounted for. And we brought that to the attention of our client and decided to do some further investigation on that. Can I have the next slide? At that time, Jared started looking at some of the old historical map resources, mainly the oil and gas map, which was made somewhere around 1905. I'm not exactly sure the exact publication date is for that, but it located numerous possible locations for farmsteads, and the little yellow squares mark locations that we believe could possibly still exist. And we sort of designed a little reconnaissance or type survey to go out and investigate if there is any potential for archaeological remains at these locations. And we found that if you see the yellow squares with the white circles, we found archaeological remains at each and every one of those locations. And then we selected with the green arrows farmstead sites and other types of historic structure sites that should be investigated further. The ones that were excluded either weren't found due to some sort of ground disturbance. In some cases, there was some major earth borrowing. Of this area is a sludge lagoon. There's two house locations there that obviously would not be relocatable. And we proceeded with the selection of sites that still had a good number of remains still present to do what we call a phase one type level investigation.
Define remains. You're referring to foundations?
Foundations.
not like human remains.
Yeah, and just to keep those things simple, these were where farms were. In most of the cases, they're...
It could be an outhouse.
There were a house, there had been a barn, and other outbuildings. There is a couple of schools, or one or two schools and a church.
What timeframe did you say is there?
Homesteads.
Yeah, let me back up a little bit. You know, we use a lot of jargon, and I apologize for that. But when I'm talking about historic sites, we're talking about anything that postdates European contact. But these things, the oldest, I think, were like 1860.
I don't think I'm allowed to. What year is that?
1492?
Well, we come over here on the ship.
Everything before that, we use the term prehistoric. After that, we tend to use the term historic. And please don't confuse the term historic with the other use of that word, which refers to historic properties, and that's an NHPA thing. But historic refers to the historic era, and that's how I'm using that here. Prehistoric is basically Indian stuff. Everything before the white guy got here.
Usually in Ohio, prehistoric divide is 1650.
Yeah. You know, in fact, Jared and I were talking about this on the way up. We're rushing through things here. There's a lot of background that we could be very happy to present to people sometime and talk about the timelines. But Ohio's prehistory spans about 12,000 years. Right after the glaciers receded, people moved in here.
It existed before that, probably.
Well, we don't have any good archaeological evidence of that, but if there has been some sites in various parts of the New World, we're people here. But Ohio had a mile of ice on it, and the glaciated part of it, and we don't have any remains of anyone walking around that side.
Okay, so then you talk about the farm. You're talking about Indian.
No, we're talking about people from the 1860s.
After Christopher came.
Most of these farms were abandoned when the government purchased
European contact.
Yeah. But anyways, the goal is to document these and to do some, at this stage, some level of investigation.
I wasn't on the page like
that. Do you have any idea why the government picked these
this spot here?
And if those people were forced to, like, eminent domain to sell their land to the government?
Well, I don't know. I don't know how that worked. I don't know what the incentive was. I do know we did look at some of the deeds, and a lot of these deed places were bought out for pretty handsome prices. They did pretty well. And in fact, I think they're probably the luckiest farmers in the uplands. Because one of the things I think about, I'm 46 years old, and growing up, I remember in northern Ohio, dairy farms everywhere. And in the 70s and 80s, dairy farms disappeared, except for the great big ones. All of these, or many of the ones we've investigated, were in fact dairy farms. Well, if dairy farms still operated the way these guys did, we'd be paying $40 a gallon for milk.
So this was all bought up in the 70s?
50s. But I'm talking about dairy farms. I'm talking about dairy farms disappearing. Certainly after these were bought, dairy farming like that went pretty much extinct.
They just shot them in place.
You're talking
about
the span of 20 years, and I thought dairy farming went pretty well, like in the 50s.
They may have been, but we couldn't live on milk. From producing dairy farms like that. It's just unsustainable.
So, I mean, why did they pick this spot?
You know, I don't know. I'm sure there's a reason. I mean, I read, and there might be some other folks that know why they did, but I know there was a selection of sites, and they liked this one. I think it's...
Water was one reason. Lots of water came.
Water was one of them, yeah. It's sort of... I've been living in Ohio all my life. I never knew this place existed until our site called me.
Because there are
going to
be ones like three, right? The industry's out there, a lot of it's the transportation and the water.
Yeah, I've read some of the documentation of why this place was selected. I just don't remember the details.
There's like transportation and water in a lot of places, but I've heard that they think this kind of rural place is. The DOE tends to pick sites like that due to demographic
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know.
It'd been difficult to try to put in Columbus.
Like, go there and make, you know.
Just because you're turning on the city first.
Who has nuclear bomb or weapons and you just got here because nobody around there's been complaining because they're all poor farmers.
But it would have been difficult.
Poor farmers and they're pretty sharp and you don't measure them.
But the whole landscape, well, how landscape was filled up with these kinds of folks.
The rest of the people out there, then you can convince them that they can work for your contaminated facility.
I don't know how these people thought. I think people back then were a lot smarter than people probably are today.
I go with that. I'll vote for that.
I've met a lot of these little farmers and they're pretty sharp. I think the dollars.
They had to do with that European contact.
And they sold these farms for a pretty good price.
It wasn't because it was cheaper, did it?
No, and there are, I think we ran across one case.
Yeah, that's what I said. I said that
the spot was sold. All the ones we reported.
It's called natural succession.
All right, let's come back to the archaeology.
Yeah, that's way above my pay grade. So, but anyways, I'm just trying to demonstrate our efforts to locate historic farms as we are, efforts to document those. We proceeded with phase one level investigations, which involve what we call shell testing on a regular grid. We want to locate artifacts. That's what defines an archaeological site, the presence of artifacts. And it's mostly trash, which we're talking about trash left behind by the people that live there.
In theory, the landfill would be a really large archaeological find in the future. We applied the same process.
Everything we do is. And everything we deposit on the ground, we're creating an archaeological record
even if Elsie and dairy cows could create an archaeological farm.
Yeah. All right, can we have the next slide? Looking at aerial photos is one of the tools we use. We use this tool in our planning process in advance to our investigations. And we also use it when we're in the field. We want to locate. You can barely see on here, but right here is a house.
A trailer.
Here's a big dairy barn. There's another small barn here. An outbuilding of some sort. It turned out this is a garage. And we'd like to compare between the different dates of the aerials. That's the best information we have. We only have two aerials.
Aerial 51.
That's a big farm. It's probably Lester Shy Farm. Because he's a dairy farmer.
That's the conspiracy.
This right isn't the, I can't remember offhand who had that farm. But they called it the Bamboo Farmstead when it was first.
It's Area 51, that's what it says there.
Documented because there's some river game going on. But the aerials are useful to seeing how farms change. Sometimes they changed a lot between 39 and 51.
Some got bigger.
Some got smaller. And in some regards, some of them look like they are in decline. In other cases, they look like they are building.
Now we have trailers.
Here's a woodlot here, and you can see that this woodlot changed. I don't know, from timber and timber harvest. Can I have the next slide? And this is the same exact farmstead I showed on the aerial. One of the things we do, or are interested again, is looking to see where the artifacts are. And we do that by excavating small holes on a regular grid. And I don't know if you guys can see it, but these little blue square, cross signs indicate severely excavated those holes. They're about 1.5 by 1.5 by 4 feet. And it's all screened through a combination. We collect all the artifacts, bring them in. And can I have another slide? And this map is the resulting distribution of data. These are sort of like contour maps, and the darker the shading gets indicates the higher frequency or higher quantity of artifacts. So we have big concentrations with many artifacts, but this is a scatter of how artifacts are distributed at this site. And we like to see that in relationship to the buildings. This is a unique farm in the sense that all the buildings are pretty close together. Many of the other farms are
pretty much spread out. A lot of it had to do with the type of landform they were on. If they were in narrow bottoms, they might have been stretched out over a long area, or if they're on a big broad ridge or a bend, they could spread out a little bit more. In most cases, the artifacts tend to be clustered right on the house seat. And can I have the next slide? The previous slide was, and when I'm talking about these artifacts, I'm talking about glass fragments, ceramics, you know, plates, dinnerware, that type of thing. This map shows where architectural remains are, mostly window glass, nails, hardware, and various things like that. Can I have the next slide? We also, one of the things that Jared specializes in addition to all the other things he specializes in is in geophysical survey. We use a variety of instrumentation. At the historic sites, we like to use a ground penetrating radar, which some of you might be familiar with for various reasons. But we're looking for subterranean features. Architectural remains that aren't visible on the ground surface. And in this case, we found what's called a trap cellar. It's about, well, I don't know, 6 by 6 foot square, and maybe 2.5 feet down. And that was located directly under the house. So there would have been a trap door to access. And it would have been, back in the day, it would have been used for storage, temporary storage.
Root cellar,
as
they call it.
Temporary root cellar.
No, roots.
Roots. We have different types of root cellars. There are external root cellars. There's a big structures built on the hillsides. It's sort of like an igloo type.
I think if we follow each other, we just built them early.
So, and then just to illustrate, this is the type of documentation we do. We do drawings. We measure the drawings in. And this is a profile, vertical profile going down. And actually, it's this. And it would be this wall, but I was giving an idea. Just another way to document many features in addition to the photographs. And this is the plan view here, which is this okay, Jeremy. Can I have the next slide? These are some of the better artifacts that we got from these sites. And these are various whitewares and pearlwares that I think most of these were manufactured prior to 1880. Some of them had manufacturing date from 1785 to 1864. Here's one that was manufactured in the 1940s. Next slide. Some other examples of the same type of stuff. Next slide. And then again, just some various things. These are smoking pipes. These are clay pipes.
Like a roach one.
I understand that these are used. They're disposable. They came with your tobacco. When you bought your tobacco, and you kept your personal reed, and you would insert them into that clay pipe. And they fell out of favor when the movie stars started smoking cigarettes on the early movies. People started smoking cigarettes.
I forgot the kids to do it.
Oh, you just don't look cool with those unless you're hiding behind the burner. But we call them marbles, glass beads.
Someone lost their marbles.
Various types of buttons and pennies, bottles, and dowel pendants, ceramic dowel pendants. And there's another slide. Oh, that's it. And that's ongoing work. We're still plugging away at it. And we're going to be moving next. I think there's some discussion about doing some additional survey work to look for prehistoric era settlement sites. Not the mound type stuff per se, but where people will live, more of their domestic type sites. So
it's fair to say there's been a fair amount of evaluation, review. Is there anywhere that's had more historical review?
Well, what's happening here is pretty typical for what we do.
Besides
what we do every day.
Right now, we're doing 1,700 acres in the forest, national forest, main national forest. I think there's timber areas and fire control areas and whatnot. That's pretty standard. Most of our project areas aren't 3,700 acres, but...
But over this period of time, there's been a lot of review.
What we're doing now is pretty much what we normally do. And this is what we do on a daily basis. We're doing gas lines and, back when they were building houses, we were doing...
So there wasn't like a second serpent mound here from what we can tell?
At this point, no.
Or a third or something?
No. But there could be some nice quality prehistoric settlement sites on that we haven't discovered yet. And that's something we're going to be, I think, looking into.
Phase one or two or whatever?
Yeah, at the phase one survey level.
What are the parameters of your study? Obviously, how far outside? Are you just on the site itself?
We're working strictly on site, and there's no authority to go elsewhere. Now, Jared was able to do what he did because he's looking at published resources and published data.
So everything is within the reservation or...
Going beyond that is a whole different ball of wax.
But the process or the study protocol, whatever term you want to use, that you use to look at this site or this acreage is the same process you go through when you're hired to look at other acreage?
Yes. I mean, we're probably... Disfect stuff that Jared did is not that typical. That's something that...
Like the eyeliner, is that done everywhere? Everywhere in Ohio, every square inch?
Well, I don't know if there's a data available for all of Ohio.
LiDAR?
Yeah. Done everywhere?
Yeah. The whole
but
state.
It's not common. It's not... This use is something Jared offered up.
Everywhere in Ohio. Every little nip, every little bump, every square inch of Ohio has been done that way?
Not what Jared's done.
It's been flown. The data exists. Although the data at Ports are much higher density than the rest of Ohio, so it's a unique opportunity here at Ports to look at these little bumps.
Jared sort of adapted the idea to this specific for this site.
Within your scope of work, your client is DOE?
Our client has been RSI, and we're doing stuff through DOE.
And were you inhibited in this contractual arrangement in any way from looking at finding, or was there any?
No.
No, in fact, it's
any caveats whatsoever.
Every suggestion that we brought up, they pretty much went.
So you had free reign to do professionally what you felt like you needed to do?
Absolutely.
What is RSI?
RSI is
Restoration Services.
Restoration Services, and their role they mentioned earlier in the presentation.
Is it? I mean, who funds that?
DOE. Yeah.
Okay, so DOE contracting.
Yeah, we're a subcontractor of a contractor on behalf of DOE.
We could get the Native Americans to come back and volunteer their time, so we can find someone else to do it.
So you're basically like the DOE
ourselves. Yeah. I have not received that title from anyone. In fact, there's two other firms working, and we've given sort of a role of kind of coordinating and all that, and trying to get everyone on board, make sure everyone's doing the same quality and level of work. But to call me the DOE,
Then you're a DOE contractor,
you know?
Right?
Yeah, but you have a title, so. And I'm not the only one.
Those are called leading questions, but I'm not here. Yeah. Don't play one on TV either.
Are there questions for Albert? It feels like the group's a little punchy. Will showed up. What do you say we take a 5-minute break?
Well, let's take